Yeah, exactly.
No, we should try to get together maybe at Tim Hortons or someplace before we all head home.
Yeah, it's just up the street.
Yeah.
When you submitted the film, you had sent not just the movie, but quite a heavy email with a lot of information regarding the movie and what surrounded it, and the fact that you were a student played a big part in the fact that this movie got made. Is that right?
I guess so.
Can you explain a little bit of that to the audience?
The film was given the ethics review certificate, and that was a very important part of making the film, because I didn't want to get sued by the Children's Aid, and I didn't want trouble from them, which could have happened. One of the foster parents in the film, they actually got criminally sued. They spent a lot of money and time trying to get those charges thrown out of court. That was for going to the Toronto Star with their story. And the Children's Aid actually did complain to Ryerson University about the making of the film. And because the film had an ethics review certificate, they couldn't do much about it.
You'll notice in the film there's no representation from anybody from the Children's Aid Society. You may ask yourself, well, why? What's their side of the story? The reason for that is?
Well, I tried.
And they said no, they didn't want to participate.
I did try to get the participation.
They were all here today.
They were all invited. I know many of them myself.
So, please stand up. The film's
a difficult film, and it raises a lot of issues. And but I think primarily from my standpoint, having done this work for a long time, is that the emphasis should not be on apprehending children. You heard the funding formula provides an incentive for Children's Aid Societies to actually take children away from their biological parents. But instead, that money, and the theme you may have has been recurring here, is that all those millions of dollars in resources should be spent helping these people out. Because we're not talking about the most serious cases where you've got horrific abuse or things like that. Those are easy to spot, and they are a very tiny fraction of the overall amount. But the amount of cases that clog up our court system, and we have a couple of people here from our family court, all those cases could be dealt with far differently. And if you were to provide the help to the usually poor people, people stuck in poverty, then there'd be much better outcomes for these children. And there are studies. Tanis Smith was one of the young ladies speaking about where's the study that says that foster care is better for kids. It doesn't exist. There are studies that say, in fact, foster care is detrimental, and it's actually better to do nothing, keep them in their own families. The kids that are in foster care have a higher incidence of criminality later on, teenage pregnancies, drug abuse, inability to hold jobs, and so on. And these are the situations where you've got, say, a single mother where she doesn't have enough food in the fridge, where she's got to leave her kids alone for a couple of hours because she has to work late, can't get a babysitter, or has to go get medicine for her child and leave her alone in the house. Whenever you do something like that, it's neglect, and it triggers all kinds of responses. And, I mean, this system needs to be overhauled right from the bottom up. And people need to be aware of that. Thank goodness we have people here who are interested enough to see this video. I hope that I'm at least a credible voice. I'm not somebody who's just complaining about the CAS, treated me poorly. I see the system from an arm's length, and I see how unfair it is. And I see that as a society, we're throwing money and time and effort into actually destroying families and harming children instead of helping them. The whole approach needs to change. And if the social workers came in, instead of apprehending first and asking questions later, if they saw what was going on, you take the mother, you buy her a bag of potatoes, you show her how to cook, you clean her house for her. But God forbid any social worker is going to do anything like that. But that's really, you need concrete help. And that the kid gets to stay with his mom instead of being shuttled around in the system, foster placement to foster placement to foster placement, where the incidence of abuse is significant, but it is hushed up. Yes?
Just one thing you mentioned just now. If you've ever been to a group home, especially in Hamilton, I'm Nick from the video, by the way.
Yeah.
I don't feel like standing up there.
That's fine.
but I've worked for several of the homes here. And how you just described, the house is a little messy, it needs to be cleaned up. Go to a group home at 9 o'clock before we've had a chance to clean it up, before we've had the kids in bed. It's worse than parents' homes at times.
Yeah.
And that's with 3 to 6 staff working.
And those group homes are really challenging. And I applaud you for doing that work because it's got to be difficult.
I'm currently retired.
Well, that's great, but you've lived through it. But these kids are warehoused, and there's no connection. There's nobody that loves them or cares about them. You guys are there. You're doing the best you can. But you have no attachment to these young people.
We're told not to.
Exactly, and you're specifically told not to. And it's the same thing in foster care when they get young kids in who are 3 or 4 or developmentally vulnerable, and the foster parent is told, you cannot develop an attachment to this child. You cannot love this child. What kind of an environment is that for a little kid? It's got to be pretty bad at home for you to take him out of the home and put him in with some strangers that are basically, they're warehousing. Yeah.
Okay. So foster care, I'm friends with Michael.
Yes.
Now foster screening.
Yeah.
So foster, take the word away, so because it has a bad representation of one. But so the screening needs to happen, but I do see the need for some sort of connection with, so this one woman who was a coke addict, if I saw my neighbor who wasn't, she was on coke or I might call, I need somebody to call to help her out, or her kids, because we're not talking about someone who doesn't have food in their fridge. We're talking about somebody who has an addiction, who needs help, and now her kids are just wandering in the streets. So now what do we do? So I'm seeing a screening needs to happen with, quote, foster people, families, and so that they have access to their kids, but I do see a need for these kids to have a place to go, but the system isn't working, obviously. And to say that foster families are abusive, which, is that always the case?
No.
I see how they need some place to go,
yeah. But
the connection needs to happen with families and whoever these kids are being rescued by. But it's not working.
Well, that's a great point, because often, what does happen is once the kid is removed into foster care, the biological parents have no contact with the foster parents.
That's
like a wall
that's
put up, and the society has their reasons for that. We have to protect the privacy of the foster parents and all of this kind of stuff. But what you're talking about makes good sense. It's like respite care, where you've got, maybe on a temporary basis, while this mother gets her act together. We'd all agree that you can't have somebody struggling on coke looking after kids, although it has been done, but you're not a very good parent when you're doing it. But to take the child away from the mom and put that child in with strangers is the most radical response to the problem that you can imagine. So there's all kinds of other things that you can do prior to that, and one would be like a respite care, where the kid goes with some people temporarily. We monitor mom's
strangers.
Progress.
They're still strangers.
Yeah. Or they could be extended family or friends.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know what sort of, but
there's not a lot of flexibility.
I see the need, but I see how the system doesn't work, but I still see the need for extreme cases.
That's to comment on that. Selena Reitberger in Thunder Bay, the lawyer, that's what she was trying to describe. That's what she's advocating for. She's saying that when you take a kid away from parents, whether the parent's a coke addict or an alcoholic or whatever the situation is, you need to first pull on the community, the child's community. Mm-hmm. The aunts, the uncles, the grandparents, the relatives, the people that care, whoever that is, the church, if the child belongs to a church. And that's not happening, right? Because the Children's Aid chooses to circumvent the community, and that's what she's advocating for.
Right.
Good question. Yeah, I did have a question. I was just wondering, I think when a society takes the children from a family, parents, my understanding is that happens in a court procedure, but isn't that all sealed, so no one knows how anything happens? So if it's all sealed, how can there be any accountability? Like, if the public can't, like, how do you fix that? If they go in there, and I think there's only like 5 or 6 days notice that they do, so they get 5 days notice, they tell this parent, 5 days from now we're going to court to take your kids, and then you end up in court. And usually 5 days, I don't know, if you haven't gone to law school, if you just work somewhere, you may not have, 5 days may not prepare you enough to go and represent yourself before the court. And then I think the CAS, when that happens, it's all secret, so the public can't know what's happening. And then I just think when things are done in secret, abuse can easily creep in. And like, how do you fix it if you don't even know what happened?
That's
like,
a great point.
I went to the courthouse a couple weeks ago, and I looked on it and had a CAS against some parent. I don't know. They just had the initials, and I thought, oh, I'll go see what's happening. Just, you know, I'm going to see how the process works.
And this man walked over
the court room, and I can't do it. And I thought, what the heck is this? It's like a star chamber.
Exactly.
No, but that doesn't make any sense.
No, and in some of the states in the U.S., they've taken away that secretive nature of child protection proceedings. And the rationale for that was to protect the privacy of the family.
Yeah, but
what it does, as somebody said, it's code for secret.
Yeah,
so that the society avoids scrutiny. And all those legal proceedings should be wide open to the public. So you can see what is being said, how it's being said, how are people being treated.
I have no idea.
Because you might be shocked at that as a regular person. I see it all the time. Yeah. But you, as somebody off the street, might be appalled by how a person is being treated in the Superior Court of Justice, whose kid has just been taken away, who doesn't have a lawyer, or doesn't have a lawyer that knows anything about the case. And then you've got the society with affidavits like this, and social workers and all this stuff. You say, well, this isn't right. So one of the areas of reform in child welfare, in my view, is exactly that, is we take away the secret aspect of the proceedings, and we make it wide open so that anybody can see what's going on.
Yeah.
Unless the parents say, the parents should have the right and the option to say at the outset, we don't want this published because it's to protect us.
Because it's the parents and children.
They don't have that option. They don't have that option right now.
Like that doesn't seem
fair. It's to protect the identity of the child.
Yeah.
That's not true either.
Well, that's the reason, that's the official reason that's given. We want to protect the identity of the child. But there are also all kinds of other considerations at play.
So. Oh, I understand that, but that's
just to be clear.
Rationale.
I would say, I understand it's to protect the identity of the child, but I think maybe you should look at the parent-child bond. This is what you're doing. What's happening, I think. You raise your kids one day, 5 days later, you're in court, and they're saying they're taking your kids. And if you're the parent of the child, you say, you know what? I'm not having this. I don't want to have all this done in the dark behind closed doors. Mm-hmm. And then somebody says, sorry, this will be done that way. That's doesn't seem fair to me.
Might be worth a challenge.
So, I don't know.
Maybe the next one I get, I'll do it.
Question here.
Well, of course, I have
a question here.
Yes.
We all know there's huge problems with CAS. We're convinced of that.
before we arrived. Just more so with this, more of the same old stories. It's good. Good work. But has anybody come up with all your research with a simple alternative mechanism? You know, like, surely you're a lawyer. You deal with, it's all law. It's all politics. We need to change law. So, no, I don't need a law. Wait a second. Do you have something? Yes or no?
Or number one. Okay, I mean, there are ways to do things differently, and they're well documented, study after study. It's just you got to have the political will to do it. And we almost had it. We almost had it up until a few weeks ago.
But how do we get a copy of that? How do we know what that is? I'm interested in that.
Child welfare reforms?
Well, that's a rather broad term. I'm
do
saying,
a Google
here's
search
the document,
on Ontario.
Here's an alternative to the Child Act. Yeah. Here, you know, rip it up, throw it out, and here's a new one.
Yeah. We're not just it? Standing here saying, destroy, 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 without having a, without having an alternative. There are alternatives. There's lots of alternatives.
But where?
Like, it's been oversight.
Have a document prepared. Does anybody have anything prepared? That's what I'd like to see. I want that.
Okay. Well, I'll give you a great website. NCCP.org. Look at that. Look that up. It's an American. It's an American website, but they have. Put a lot of time and thought and effort and money into their lobby group down south. And they've got, you know, 10 or 12 ways of reforming child welfare that will improve outcomes for kids and families. Because the focus is, we got to do what's best for the kid. But when you take a child away from the parents, you destroy the parents. So how does destroying the child's parents help the child?
See, I agree with that. Well, we have a political, we have a grand spring election, okay? And it looks like this. Probably going to be an NDP sweep,
yeah.
And they're NDP and the Conservatives. Has anybody worked with these people? Because it doesn't matter.
It's not really on the radar.
Bring it into.
They've been worked with. They're being worked with on a constant basis.
Constantly.
The NDPs and PCs
yeah.
are being worked with.
Well, HUDAC, I've talked to him five times.
Even the Liberal side.
No, it's not on the radar. Except, allow me to say this: that Monique Taylor is a MPP here in. Hamilton Mountain for the NDP. She put forward a private member's bill
yes,
to allow the ombudsman oversight. It passed your second reading, which is
Yay.
The farthest it's ever gone. Fantastic. It's going to committee. It's going to be law. Until, what happened?
McGinney resigned.
McGinney shut everything down.
No.
So all that's dead. We got to start all over again.
Did it on purpose.
Although we might not be starting all over again. It could pick up.
One gentleman had cleaners coming into his house, so he obviously had enough money to hire
right.
a cleaner. And he got his kids back in 16 days. The observation that I made was all the other people that were in that film didn't have money. They relied on legal aid, and it took them years and are still fighting. So money is a key thing.
Education.
Money, lots of money and education.
Not always.
You can get your kids back fairly quickly.
Robert,
well, that's only one variable.
One.
Yeah.
Right?
There's a lot of variables. Yeah. But you're right. I mean, having a decent lawyer.
16 days he got his kids back. Yeah. And all of the other people had to rely on aid and couldn't get their kids back.
Well, can I just comment
one,
on that?
Yeah.
I overturned a Crown Board chip. I have no money.
Yeah. I also wanted
I
to
did it.
On that
education.
The situation he was just discussing
in the film.
Oh, and I'm a recovering addict, too.
So that's a great outcome for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that took a lot of work and time, I'm sure.
I overturned it a year after I was clean.
Yeah, that's great.
There was a situation there that
that's
he was discussing. Sorry,
good.
He was discussing a situation about how Mr. McQuaid in there got his child back 16 days later.
Yeah.
I can sit here and honestly tell you, Chung Zay came into my house based on lies, apprehended my child, had me arrested for breach of the peace. I was released that same night with no charges after I was handcuffed. I went to court 4 days later with my lawyer, with legal aid, with no money, served the children's aid with a motion for the immediate return of the child before they even served us with documents, and the courts ordered my son returned 4 days after they took him.
Yeah.
And it was all based on lies, but it took me 18 months to get him out of my life. And there was one other comment I wanted to make to this gentleman up here because he wanted to know what the solution was. And I can honestly tell you, I've dealt with two different agencies, one in Ontario and one in Quebec. And Quebec used to actually be a private corporation at one time, and the solution they came up with was they actually took the roof right off the CAS, got rid of the private corporation altogether, went with a government-run agency out there, where all the workers were required by law to be registered with the college to practice social work or work within the agency. And out there, they took away the actual funding that they had, the funding formula of the amount of children they had in care, and they actually had the incentive to get the children home faster because it was costing them
that's
money.
That's great. That's the root of it. And if you want to come up with sort of the magic bullet, the first thing you would do is change that funding formula so that there's not an incentive to put kids in care. There's an incentive to return kids to their homes and provide the parents with the help that they need. So if you reversed it, that would go a long way on it.
That second part was the other comment that I wanted to make, is that if the social workers were accountable and they could be held accountable when they put children in situations that are harmful situations, I think that would help.
Well, it's a very difficult job, and you got to make judgment calls all the time.
But it's like, I work in the water and wastewater industry. If I have a license to run a water treatment plant, and I do something like what happened in Walkerson, I'm accountable.
A lot of lies are at stake.
I get fine.
You're dealing with mechanics and not human beings, with all due respect. Much different situation.
Something could be put in place, like what has been put in place in Quebec.
Deborah.
From my limited experience, social workers dealing with the society, working for the society, oftentimes are right out of school. Not always, but a lot of them. There is a huge burnout rate, like 5 years. And so in the course of a family's life, where over the course of 10 years you have 3 or 4 children, let's say, you could go through or you could be involved with 3 or 4 social workers. So it's like new all the time.
That's a problem.
And that is a huge problem because of the lack of continuity. And that is a fact. Very few social workers last a long time.
Yeah, the other aspect to this is not only you've seen how dysfunctional the whole process is, but the amount of money that's being spent on it. $1.5 billion with a B, is given to how many societies do we have?
48.
That's 88,000 per kid?
Yeah,
per year.
$88,000
per child per year. So when you've got a bureaucracy that's big, eventually, the bureaucracy is going to conduct itself in such a way that is in the best interest of the organization as opposed to the best interest of the people it's trying to serve. And this just happens, but it's happening.